Part 53.
This morning we're going to continue our teachings on the 9 helpful hints in reading God's word. I've been dealing with this 9 helpful hints in reading God's word under the teachings called to be a champion. And I just want to bring your attention to one truth that I've always been mentioning earlier. Champions are not born, they are made. One day at a time. Can I have an amen, please? Champions are not born, they are made one day at a time. Now, you will find champions in every area of life. Although we are going to come back to the 9 helpful hints in reading out God's word. This morning I was just reading about a head of state who was to visit our land. And he's been threatened with a lot of things, one of which is the political parties of our land are threatening to stage a strike when he does arrive. So someone asked him, aren't you concerned about this? Aren't you worried about it? He said, these things help boost me up. In fact, I may even join one of them. Please listen, nobody just becomes a head all of a sudden. These are statements you and I ought to learn from. Because in different fields you find different champions. Now this man and his name, I have never read of or heard in my growing up years. But now he is the head of a nation. Meaning, every day in times gone by, he must have had to face challenges. When he was a nobody, when the limelight was not on him, he had to go through the process of coming to a place where he would someday stand in a position of championship. Now, that's exactly how it is with Christian believers also. Never neglect every day, because every day is a part of your making. Every day is a day which carves out the character that will ultimately be on the inside of you. You see, erratic Christians, they never do anything in life. Why? Because they are erratic. They live by fits and starts. They never submit to everyday routine in which God is at work in their life. Sometimes they are so disinterested in what God is doing that they fail to understand that God is watching them every day. Every day He is watching them. Whether they do something or they don't do something, God's watching them. God's finding out what's on the inside of them. And in the process, every day contributes in the making of the real you. Because you're the sum total of the days you have lived on the face of this earth. Now, look at Deuteronomy chapter 6, please. I told you that the 8th helpful hint in reading out God's word is to understand that this is the word of God. And it's good for you to give it out as special gifts to those you love. Nothing is more important than God's word. If you say you love somebody, the first thing you ought to give to that somebody is not a bouquet of roses. It's God's word. Because God's word is the ultimate. In fact, it got the roses into being in the first place. Now, when you understand that God's word means everything to you, you find yourself waiting to be in a position to give out the best thing possible to somebody you love. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, we looked at some amazing things about how God spoke through Moses to Israel as a nation to do something. He told them that they would get into places of great prosperity. But there was one thing that they had to guard themselves against doing. Forgetfulness. Forgetfulness is the bane of the Christian believer in all places of worship. Most often people forget the way in which God touched them. God led them. God counseled them and prospered them. And when they do arrive in places of great blessing, the first thing that they do is start learning about things they shouldn't be learning. And that hurts God. Can I have an amen, please? That hurts God. Now, remember, in verse 14, Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 14, you shall not go after other gods of the gods of the people which are round about you. Now, the gods of the people, like I told you earlier, take on different forms and shapes and sizes. They are not necessarily idols, but most often they are practices which are continually followed by people of different faiths and different beliefs. Now, the gods of the people are gods that you find pressure being applied on the believer to follow. God is a jealous God. He says, don't go after them. I don't want you running after them. Why? Because I am the one who delivered you. I am the one you must serve. And I am the one you must follow all the days of your life. You shall not tempt the Lord your God as you tempted him in Massah. Look at verse 17. You shall diligently keep the commandments of the Lord your God and his testimonies and his statutes which he hath commanded you. Now the word diligence is a word that features often in crucial portions of scripture. I want you to highlight that word forever, not just in your Bibles but in your heart. What is the meaning of the word diligence? Diligence, simply put, is steadfast application. That means you apply yourself steadfastly every day to following the word. When it looks like you want to grumble, you say, no, I'll praise the Lord. The question immediately comes into your mind, but why? You don't have anything to praise the Lord for. But the moment that question arises in your mind, you say, no, but I have God's word with me. And God's word demands that the king be worshipped at all times. So you choose to worship the Lord. You choose to praise the Lord. You choose to declare his faithfulness. Remember, being a follower of the word or a doer of the word, it's not just going to fall into your lap so easily. It takes every day application of the word in your lives to arrive in a place where God says, well, this is the champion that I have in my mind. This is the person I have on my heart. This is the man or the woman I'm going to use. This is the person I can now trust with prosperity, that I can now trust with good success, that I can now trust with blessing. Why? Because he will not only live it out in his life, but he'll command his children after him in my ways. So being a doer of the word is not just going to be a once in a lifetime matter, nor is it going to be a occasional choice that you adopt at certain times of your life. You follow the word every day. You keep at it every day. You steadily apply yourself every day. There's been a very dismal performance by our cricket team in Durban. And everybody is crying foul. Some say don't pay them. Some say pay them less than what they really deserve. Let it be a performance-based payment. Now, someone was being interviewed yesterday, who's being deputed to go and meet the cricket team. He's being sent to put them back on track. So they kept asking him 101 questions. Now, he had finished his time of, you know, speech, and there was another person also being asked questions, another cricketer. And he made a statement. He said, when the cricketer is standing there, he's not bothered about what his payment is going to be. Because he sees only one thing hurtling and coming towards him at 90 kilometers per hour, the ball. You're not going to be distracted at that point of time. Can I have an amen, please? You are not going to be distracted at that point of time. Why? Because distractions can cost you dearly. Forget about getting out. You can get hurt bad. So that's not the time he's going to be thinking, what's my payment going to be? It's his life against the ball. Now that's exactly how it is when D-Day comes for a champion to stand and to face what God says you can do. You can make it through this situation. He doesn't have everything on his mind at that point of time. There's only one thing he's focused with. What's he focused on? One thing. What is it? What is confronting him? What is confronting him? Now, keep this in mind, please, as you read Deuteronomy chapter 6 and verse 17. Highlight the word diligently in your Bibles, please. What do you do? Diligently keep the commandments. And then verse 18 says, and thou shalt do that which is right and good in the sight of the Lord. Highlight the word do. Now, what do you do is the question. Do what is good and right in the sight of the Lord. Now, God didn't look at Moses and tell him, do what is good and right in the sight of people. Now, I hear people this morning. There's a lot of things I can do which is good and right in the sight of people, which may not be good and right in the sight of God. I want you to come with a highlighter, please. You want to be a champion? You want to see God's word work in your life? Then do what is good and right in the sight of the Lord. You will be at some point unpopular. There will be people who will not like you. Some of them will think, well, he is attempting to show off. Maybe he is walking with a holier than thou attitude. So please listen. We are called to live a holy life, but not a holier than thou attitude. What is a holy life? A holy life is based on the holiness that God gives us. A holier than thou attitude is based on measuring your self-worth with somebody else. Now please listen, there's a imperfection that takes place if you live that kind of a life. I want you to write it down. Because that's how most Christians live. They measure themselves with someone else. Don't. Because you're measuring yourself with a man who's already imperfect. And sooner or later you will lower your standard of holiness. You will achieve far less than God wants you to have. What does God want you to have? His holiness. He said, be ye holy, for I am holy. So his holiness is what we receive and live out. But you look at a man who lives his life with a holier than thou attitude, he becomes a terrible pain. You call him a pain in the head or a pain in the neck or just a pain. But you're just trying to explain somebody who's not doing any good whatsoever. Why? Because this person is basing his holiness on you or on someone else. He says, I'm better than so and so because I do this, I do that. And see, that person doesn't do this and that. Now follow very carefully. Do that which is right and good in the sight of the Lord. The word right means righteousness. What is the meaning of the word righteousness? The word righteousness simply means right standing with. So how do you do righteousness? By letting the righteousness of God manifest every day in your life. Is it a struggle? No. It all depends on how much you learn to submit. There's no struggle really. If you learn to submit, the more you learn to submit, the more the righteousness of God manifests. It becomes a struggle when you think, I have to do something to contribute to that righteousness. Then it becomes a struggle. Because you fall flat on your face even before you start off. Now it's a terrible strain for you. Thoughts keep moving through your mind that you never thought were there. And it disturbs you. And you become guilty. And you feel bad about a lot of things. That's not exactly what God wants you to have. What does God want you to have every day? Not a struggle with thoughts, but rather a submission to His life. The life of Christ. The righteousness of Christ. Every day you have a choice to make. Which side of the knob of life you will turn? In which direction? Either Godward or in the opposite direction to God. Which side will you turn the dial to? Either praise and worship or murmuring and complaining. Just the other day I was talking to somebody. I asked this individual a question. And the individual was able to see through something that was troubling her. I asked her only one question. What was the sin that got people killed in the wilderness? What got them killed anyhow? Forget about the sin. What got them killed? You will never read that they starved to death. You will never read, even though there was no proper water initially, they dehydrated and killed themselves. Or dehydration killed them. The wilderness is an awful place to be in. Why? Because it's not a place of habitation really. Nor is it a place of blessing. It's a place in which you have different kinds of creatures that you don't even know of or can identify if you belong to the city. There are some insects that can sting you, that can get you killed in the wilderness. There are snakes. There are a lot of poisonous insects. And the wilderness is always a place of harsh conditions. But not once do you find the Bible recording that people died in the wilderness because of this. Even when the serpent struck people, remember, they had a chance to get back to the healer. Now these were fiery serpents that bit the people. Now listen very carefully. What got the people killed was one major sin that manifested throughout the 40 years of their wandering. Forgetfulness that was coupled together with murmuring and complaining. Write it down or just look at me and do nothing about it. Please listen. Murmuring and complaining can get you into a lot of mess. The more you start murmuring and complaining, please listen, even if it is genuine, what is genuine in your sight is not genuine in the sight of God that warrants you to complain and murmur in His sight. Why? Because there are far greater deliverances that God delivered you from than a present condition in your life. Can I have an amen, please? There are far greater deliverances that God delivered you from than a present temporary condition in your life. So you can't complain. You can't murmur. So what do you do is a question. When these thoughts come and there is a real pressure being applied on you, what do you do is the question. Well, do what God asked you to do. Do what is righteous in His sight. Worship Him. Grab your Bibles at that time. Everything will be asking you to do something exactly contradictory to that. Look the other direction. Get your mind occupied with something else. My friends, please listen. When you're dejected and depressed, don't let your minds get occupied with anything else apart from God's word. That's not a good idea to watch television at that point of time. You're not going to relax by watching a movie. You're not going to relax by watching a serial. Why? Because they'll fuel your depression the wrong direction. What do you do? Just keep reading the word. Let your mind be bathed with the word of God's, bit with God's, the water of God's word. Let it bring soothing to your hurting being. And even if you start out reading mechanically At some point, the Spirit of God will grab your attention to one verse. Maybe one word, which will be the key to your exit from your present temporary negative situation in life, and which will lead you into the next realm of blessing that He has planned and prepared for you. Is it easy? No, it's not easy. I've been walking with the Lord for 21 years. It's not going to be easy. The Christian life is never easy. But then the Christian life is lived out one day at a time. It's not a Sunday worship that will transform you and change you. Nor is it a Saturday intercessory prayer that will make something out of you. It's everyday Christian living. What do you do when people are putting the pressure on you? Do you find the pressure so much applied on you that the gods of the people now impress you? Or are you so impressed with one person? Someone told me something the other day that really thrilled my being. He said, here I was walking through office. I'd never done it earlier. But I decided we'll have no photos in our office. We'll have nothing that identifies with another religion in our office. Now he's the head of his company. He said, I decided I'll do it. There was this inner nervousness in my spirit. What will happen? But I just decided and I said, remove everything. We will not have it in this place. And the best thing is this, they did it. My friends, listen very carefully and get this good. When you're so impressed with the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, the God of covenant, when you speak, God will stand solidly behind you and back you. Just last week I told you something. I said promotion never comes easy. Promotion never comes easy. It's hard for people to understand it. Nobody simply comes and puts honor into your hand. Honor comes when you honor the one from whom honor comes. Honor comes when you honor the one from whom honor comes. Nobody just comes and calls you and says, be an advisor to the government. It takes time. It takes years. It takes everyday living. It takes everyday witnessing. Every day. I've told it to my staff. I've told it to everybody I've met. I said, if you go to Stephen's office, you'll get a liberal dose of the word before you come out. You won't just go meet him and come out in a hurry. You'll get a liberal dose of the word. He's not neglecting his work, but he will not leave you empty. He will give you the word. Whether you like it, you don't like it, you'll never visit him again. Immaterial. Immaterial. He'll give you the word. You sit in his car, you'll get the word. You travel with him, you'll get the word. And the God of the word will back you at some point. Because he sees faithfulness. He sees that underlined. He says, here's somebody who's so impressed with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, me, that I better do something for him. Local kingdoms need to recognize the man. Local governments need to recognize the man. Recognition comes when you are faithful. Please listen and listen good. This portion of scripture will set the pace for what you will do in your life and what you will invest in the lives of the one who form part and parcel of your family. People want blessing. How does the blessing come is the question. Not by you living a loose life and then your family members not being able to relate to what life you're living. Nobody knows what you're living. Nobody knows what you're believing in. Your beliefs matter. Be unashamed about your beliefs. I said, be unashamed about your beliefs. Years ago, I heard Brother John Osteen, who's gone to be with the Lord. His son is that wonderful man of God who ministers on television, Joel Osteen. I heard him speak. And he said this, he had gone to purchase a car with another person. And the salesman was liberally using filthy language. And he was just, you know, getting ticked off by the kind of language that was being used. The salesman was cursing and he was using filthy language. All of a sudden, John Austin shouted, "Praise the Lord, hallelujah, glory to God. Oh Jesus, I thank you." And the man stopped, he froze. He said, "Are you a preacher?" He said, "No, I'm just a worshiper. And I want equal time because you've been worshiping your God for quite some time now. Now I want time to worship my God. I want time to worship my God." He said, immediately the man became religious. And what would have normally taken about an hour or so to finish, the paperwork, he finished it in record time, 2-3 minutes, and sent him out. He said, "Take the key." Please listen. We are having intimidators all over the world. They are intimidating the Christian believer. So much so the Christian believer backs down. He doesn't want the name of the Lord, God, on his lips. Don't have it on your lips at all time. Have the name of the Lord God on your lips all the time. Because pressure is always being applied every day to deny him, to deny his word. Now, follow please. Look at verse 20. "And when thy son asketh thee in time to come," meaning you're going to be watched for some time by the ones in your house. Your son is not going to just come up to you and say, "Dad, teach me about Jesus." No, he wants to know whether you know Jesus yourself first. He wants to know whether you know Jesus in a personal way. And you have a definite time with him every day. He's watching you. He's wanting to see whether the Jesus you claim to serve and love is delivering you of the different kind of life circumstances that you're facing firstly. When he finds that the Jesus that you're talking about is not a myth, nor is he a fable, but a real person, in time to come, he is going to walk up to you and say, "Tell me about your God. Tell me about your God. I want to know about him." Look at the patriarchs. They're a great study of this truth. Abram had to live out his life of faith before he would become Abraham. And then after he had become Abraham, he had to still continue living by faith before Isaac would declare that your God will be my God. And the patriarchal blessing would be transferred from Abraham to Isaac. Then Isaac had to live by faith before his sons Esau and Jacob. Before one of the sons would say, "The God of Isaac will be my God." Now, understand carefully. And I've seen it. It's amazing because this truth is so powerful that it is something you must pay attention to. Here is Jacob. He is being sent away from his home to another place so many kilometers away. All alone he's walking. And he's just had a very narrow escape from getting killed by his own elder brother. He doesn't know what is awaiting him. But on the way he makes a covenant with God. What does he say? Now please listen. He says, "Lord, if you'll be with me and bless me and prosper me and take me and bring me back again safely, then you'll be my God. And of all what you give me," listen, "I will give the tenth of all, or I'll tithe it to you." Now who told him about tithing? He had seen it work earlier. He had seen God protect Isaac earlier. He had seen God prosper Isaac earlier. Now he wants this God. Because he had lived by his wits till that time. Now he wants someone to come along with him. He had heard about Abraham leaving Ur of the Chaldees and coming out. Not alone, but with this God called Jehovah, Yahweh. He had heard it from Isaac that God had protected him and his wife Rebekah from the hands of Abimelech. Now
facing an unknown future, he wanted a known God with him. Can I have an amen, please? It's far better to enter into an unknown future with a known God than to enter an unknown future with an unknown God. You must know the God you love. You must know the God you serve. You must know the God who means everything to you. So you're living out your life is not just for yourself. You're leaving something behind for posterity, because every day people are watching you. That's why you need to live a responsible life. I can do a lot of things. You don't know the guts I have. I can do a lot of things, but I don't do the things that I can do, even sometimes legally, just because I don't want to lay a stumbling block to somebody else. I don't need a big gang to be with me to do a lot of things. I've always done a lot of things alone. Listen, every day you're being watched, whether you know it or not. Don't quote, "No, I'm young." In your age group, there are people who are watching you. Every day you're being looked at closely by people who rub shoulders with you. It starts off at home. Your son watches you. Your daughter watches you. Spouse watches you. Servants watch you. Then the ones who come off and on, they watch you. Maybe they deliver something to your house. They are watching you. Maybe the pharmaceutical man. Maybe the man who irons out your clothes. Or the woman who brings the laundry and comes. Every day you're being watched. Your priorities matter. Some time ago, my house owner told me something that made me laugh. He said, "Sir, the other day someone came to my house and you were praying. And this person got all agitated. He said, something is happening on top." I looked at him and said, "No, he's just praying." He thought something was happening. Maybe a fight was on, the way you were shouting and praying. And I said, "No, he's just praying. That's the way he prays." Please listen. They watch you every day. Every day they watch you. They listen to you whether you sing songs of praise and worship. They watch you when things are not really going all that very good in your life. They want to see what comes out of your lips, your body reaction, the way your body language reads at that point of time. People are watching you every day. And please listen to this also. No one knows for sure when the day comes when God decides to put you out on display. D-Day in the kingdom of God is display day. David never knew that he was going to be displayed at that point of time. Get ready for December's newsletter. I've already written it. There's some amazing things that God's spoken to me about the seed. Yesterday I couldn't really keep pace with him in the morning. I was just writing when I got a message from Brother Frederick telling me, "Please pray for Brother Rao." I immediately typed and said, "Please tell him he's got it. He's got it." Because God told me, tell him he's got it. I said, "Call him up, tell him I'm praying." God says he's got it. It's finished. You heard him testify a little earlier. I couldn't keep pace. I showed Sheila at the end of the day. I just showed her what the Lord has been speaking to me about the seed. So many amazing things. Please listen. Saul didn't know that his display day was on when he went looking after his lost asses. All that he heard was his father tell him, "Go search for the ass." Just imagine if he had played hooky. Most people do. They think it's an ordinary command. "That's my dad telling it." No, you better listen. If you're under his authority, please listen. Because ultimately, authority matters in the kingdom of God. Just listen. It's not routine. That's what surprised me. I thought it was only David. God brought my attention to the first king of Israel. He was a listener to start off with. Only later he backslid. His father Kish was a very wealthy man. He said, "Go find the lost asses." He didn't know he was going to meet the prophet. He didn't know blessing was on its way. He didn't even know he was going to come back with God the Holy Spirit, my friends. My friends, just think about it. He went looking for lost asses. Just imagine you go looking for a notebook that is lost and you come back filled with the Holy Ghost. praying in other tongues, baptized in the spirit, and someone tells you you're going to be the boss of the company. That's something.
Get ready for seed time and harvest time. I want you to read the newsletters carefully. The newsletters are not playthings.
The last time I was fasting and praying, again the Lord had spoken something and written it down. It's amazing. Some of these things you go over, but you never really see it except when God the Holy Spirit brings your attention to it and says, tell it to my people now, because this is exactly what I'm going to do in their life. It's amazing. Simply amazing. Every day what you do matters. Persistence matters. When that desire is in you to quit, like it all of a sudden lifted its ugly head in Saul's life, he said, let's get back. My father may have stopped worrying about asses, he must be worrying about me. His servant said, no, let's go meet the prophet. Can I have an amen, please? I said, can I have an amen, please? You never know when you will start entering the next realm of blessing. You're about to quit. You're about to throw up your hands. You've come to the last tether of your energy. But you've been faithful. You've been persistent. You've been diligent. These are words that normally Christian believers don't like to listen to, because they want it just like that. Instant blessing. Someone was telling me the other day, he met a person who, when he asked him about something, he said, no, I've sent my prayer request to someone else. My friends, please listen. You've learned to pray yourself first. No wonder these kinds of abuses exist and dominate the kingdom of God to such an extent that people don't want anything to do later with that kind of a living. You learn to pray yourself. You learn to wait upon God yourself. Just think about the last couple of 6 months, maybe 6 months or 8 months. How often have you spent time alone with God, saying, God, I've turned myself off from things that normally bother me, and I want to be with you. I just want to be with you. I want to treat you special. I'm not going to ask you anything. I just don't want to ask you anything. God looks at you and says, really? You say, yeah, really. All that I want is you. I want time with you. I want to just fellowship with you and love you and respect you and make you feel real good about all that you have done in my life. I want to come with a grateful heart before you. It matters in the kingdom of God. So what happens is, this person said, I started laughing. Because here's a man, he is not willing to pray. He is not willing to pay a price. He is giving his entire life's leadership into somebody else's hand. Never do it. Never do it. So the servant looks at Saul and tells him, Saul, why don't we go meet the prophet Samuel? And still what is on Saul's mind is lost asses. He doesn't know anything else. But God has something else on his mind. First king, first choice. David was never God's first choice. It was second choice. First choice, amazingly, was Saul. In fact, the moment Samuel saw Saul, I was just reading that portion of scripture. It was thrilling me beyond anything I'd known earlier. I was wondering even whether the newsletter will be enough for me to write everything. So I've reserved a lot of other things that the Lord showed me. God loved Saul so much that the previous day he told Samuel, at this time a man will come. He's the person I have on mind for king. So the moment Samuel saw Saul, the Bible says God was so excited, he just looked at Samuel and said, this is my choice. This is my man. Can God look at you and say the same thing is the question? This is my person. It's later you find a very pained God speaking through Samuel and telling Saul, because you have rejected my word, I have rejected you. Now I found another man. His heart will match my heart. His beat will match my beat. He is a man after my own heart. What I love, he'll love. What I want, he'll want. Again, you see, David never knew that he was going to be put on display. All that he knew was, take these little rolls of cheese and meet your brothers and his boss. That's all that he knew. So when people in authority give you a command, don't grumble, murmur, complain and say, why me? Say, why not? Why not? Certainly. I'll receive it. I live it out. Have a mind difference, a change of mind and attitude that grabs a hold of you this moment. I'm not simply talking this morning. I know what I'm talking. It's all a part of, you know, showing your son who the God is that you love, serve and adore. Finally, the next thing that I want to show you. God wants to bless you always. Most people don't understand the word blessing. The word blessing is a wonderful word that means so many things to so many people, but when you look at it in the way the word of God puts it, it talks about an empowerment for good success. Look at verse 24. And the Lord commanded us to do all these statutes, to fear the Lord our God for our good always, that he might preserve us alive as it is at this day. All the time, God wants us to have good happen. Now, good manifests in your life by the things that you see being wrought by God as a result of the word dominating your hearts. Will it mean a trouble-free life is a question? No. Just because people talk about the good life, it doesn't mean they don't have anything come up their way which troubles them. Please listen. The good manifests in the presence of evil when you keep doing what God asked you to do at all times. Take the case of the three Hebrew boys, Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego. They refused to bow before the image. They didn't know that the furnace is going to be heated 7 times more than normal. They didn't know it. To start off with, they said, "Oh king, we will not bow." All of a sudden, you hear the king looking at the people who were there and saying, "Heat the furnace 7 times more." Isn't it amazing? The other day I saw something on Australian television. Just a small clip and then after that I left. I mean, I believe God sincerely wanted me to just hear that one place. Here was this a man, he was visiting a glass factory. And they were talking about how different kinds of beautiful glass vases were made. And so many other things. But one thing he said, and that's what struck me. The furnace in which directly this molten glass is put in, where the process of, you know, heating it up where it becomes so pliable starts, is called with an unusual name. I mean, when you look at that place, it's fire. It's fire at a terrific temperature. But do you know what it's called? It's called the glory place. I started laughing off the television and I pushed off. I said, that's what I needed to hear for today. The glory place. He said, put it inside the glory place. Because there in the glory place, all the dross is removed. And then it becomes pliable. The three boys never knew that it's going to be heated 7 times more than normal. But one thing they had decided, whether outside or inside, we will not bow before that image. That's what matters in life. So if you ask the people who were standing around them, they would have been pitying these boys. They would have been looking at them and, you know, some of them would have been even winking and giving them different kinds of movements with their eyes and hands, saying, just bow. Why are you going through this mess? Everything is going bad, all because you're trying to be a doer of the word. But for them, everything was good. Because they had never seen the fourth man. They had never seen the fourth man. They had never heard. They had heard about him, but they had never seen him in action. Now they were about to see him firsthand, walking with them. Right there, where the fire was the hottest, he would manifest. The best thing is this. He would preserve them alive. Isn't it amazing? That's exactly how it is in our lives. If you're thinking the Christian life is going to be a trouble-free life, I don't know who preached that message to you, but you get it right this morning, it won't. The fire will wax hotter and hotter and hotter depending on what kind of dross must leave. If it's a little bit of uncleanness, little heat will be enough. If it's a lot of uncleanness, the fire will wax hot, real hot. But at that point of time, it's up to you to decide. Like our sister did. She said, I just prayed one little prayer. I said, Lord, give me favor. If she was not a person used to praying, to tell you the truth, she wouldn't have seen favor at that point of time. I've seen people make different statements and make that kind of statements look like that's how you live out your life. They come and testify and say, I didn't have time to pray really, but I just prayed this and this happened. And everybody says, Amen, Hallelujah. And go back home thinking that's exactly how it's going to be. You just spend as scant time with God as possible. Just squeeze out a prayer now and then and He'll just come and deliver you. Sorry. It won't work at some time. Don't find it from the lions when their mouths are not stopped by the angel of God. Check out Daniel's life. A man of prayer continually. He didn't say it. The king said it. He said, the God whom you serve continually, has He sent somebody to deliver you? He said, yes, O king, live forever. Because I am alive. You heard what the brother prayed a little earlier when we started our service. Of what use is your soul if it's in the grave? But we who are in the land of the living, we'll bless the Lord. We'll worship Him and declare His faithfulness over and over again. Make prayer a part and parcel of your life. Make the reading of the word part and parcel of your life. Make the living out of the word of God part and parcel of your life. Because every day people are watching you. That way, when trouble does come, when the storms of life do blow, remember, even Jesus was not exempted. The storm came. It hit the boat on which he was. But he had learned to do something continually. Take authority. Exercise the dominion. Speak forth things into being that were not. So he did what he did always. He looked at the waves. He looked at the storm and said, peace, be still. He didn't say, let me be realistic. My friends, the whole boat would have gone down. Some people think, well, I'm being honest. Sorry. Honesty in the kingdom is not the way it is in the world. Honesty in the kingdom is saying, God, I believe your word against all negative circumstances of life. That's honesty in the kingdom. Some people cry foul and say, but, sorry. You keep the buts and let it but you. But, let me tell you something. Honesty, truthfulness, humility in the kingdom is saying what the king says. Just think about it. Jesus didn't say, yeah, let's be realistic. This is really a terrible storm. It's going to blow the boat away. The entire group of people would have been blown off. The moment he saw the storm, he rose up and said, peace. Why? Because on the inside of him, he knew kingdom living was peace. We sang about it. That's exactly how your declaration of faith ought to be. Now, the disciples, this is exactly what we're reading here. They marveled. They said, what a strange man this is. We also are maritime men. We've been on the sea. We've been on the lakes. And we've known what this kind of a situation is. We've never seen a sailor stand up and say, peace. He is cried out, oh hell. No wonder it was hellish after that. We have never seen a man rise up and speak to the waves and to the sea and bring something into being that was not. What kind of a man is this? What type of a person is this? That's exactly what your son and your daughter and the ones who interact with you will come to a conclusion finally. What kind of a man is this? When they find out, they'll start saying, what manner of a God he serves. This is King of Kings. This is Lord of Lords. Let's bow our heads in a moment of prayer, please. We're going to continue this next week, where I'm going to talk about the value of keeping your word, especially when you vow a vow. Let's bow our heads in prayer, please. And I'm going to close with prayer. Father, we're so glad we're here as one family in Christ, standing in the gap and interceding for the various needs of the ministry and the church and the body of Christ.
Amen. In Jesus' name.
And on behalf of, Lord, your plan and purpose that you have entrusted into our hands. Amen. We're so glad to be here in prayer.
Amen.
Seeking your face.
Yes, Father, in Jesus' name.
The Bible says, so God, wisdom. In the book of Proverbs said it like this: I love them that love me.
Amen.
And those that seek me early shall find me.
Amen.
We seek you early, O God.
Seek you early, O Lord Jesus.
Oh, we honor you, wisdom.
We honor you, Father, Lord Jesus.
And we lift you upon high, the wisdom of God.
Wisdom.
Pray that mighty things will be wrought in the lives of your people who are here this morning.
Amen. In Jesus' name.
To everyone, O God, who has come,
yes,
we know you give them a supernatural touch this morning.
Amen. In Jesus' name.
That will affect them in every area of their life, for spirit, soul, and body.
Amen. In Jesus' name.
Precious Father,
thank you, Father.
I commit everyone into your hands this day. I command, O God, your goodness to run and overtake the ones who are devouring your word.
Amen. In Jesus'
name. O Lord, and learning about seed faith, O Father.
Yes, Father.
We're preparing their hearts for the next level of blessing.
Hallelujah.
As they receive December's newsletter, O Father.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
I pray that there will be a supernatural
Amen.
Glory that they will see manifest
Amen.
In their lives so
yes,
far.
Agree, yes,
in the name of
Amen,
Jesus.
Agree,
in the name of Jesus.
Agree,
so they'll end 2006 with great joy
Amen.
And enter 2007 with great expectation.
Amen,
in the name of Jesus.
Amen,
thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank
great
you.
Is thy faithfulness.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody say, Amen and Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
This concludes Pastor Isaac's message.